We're back again, connectors. Different style, different look, different atmosphere. I mean, look behind me. This stage is absolutely amazing. When I walked in here, I was like, wow. If I am not part of this, I am probably going to leave this church, but I'm still here. And as you can see, my pastor couldn't get me out of here for nothing. Like, comment, share, and connect with us. With whatever that you're going to say, we love connecting with our people. And you know, we're at the top of our game at this point. And when we open church, we want to see you here. We want to see you. We can't wait to see you here, in fact. So now the praise and worship is on standby. It is going to absolutely be amazing. And the word, my goodness, you're not ready for this word if you're not ready to grow. So this is what we're all about. Praise and worship, take it away, and I'll see you right after this.
Thank you, Jesus, for your grace. Hallelujah. Tell me, what can I do? I can live without you. I can live without you. Tell me, what can I do? I can live without you. I can live without you. So here's my heart. My mind, I give you my soul, Lord. I need you to take control, 'cause I tried it on my own, but what I found is I can make it on my own. I can make it. I can make it. Sing how great, see with me how great is your good, and all will sing how great, how great is our good, our God, oh God, oh God, how great is our good. Won't you sing with me how great is our good? Yeah, 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 yeah. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. Hallelujah. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. We worship you. Jesus, l'étoile, la Jesus. Thank you.
Worship team, that was amazing. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for leading us into the throne room. We pray that the Lord would bless you abundantly. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome everyone from the comfort of their homes once again and say thank you for joining us this morning. Before we go any further, let's go to the Father in prayer. Heavenly Father, you're welcome. We thank you for all that you are doing in our lives. We thank you for the love. We thank you for the protection. We thank you for the mercy, Lord. We thank you for forgiveness, O Father. This morning, Father, we want to welcome you into the comfort of our own homes this morning. We say, Holy Spirit, come and take charge. Holy Spirit, speak. We are ready to hear from you this morning. Thank you that you are about to change our lives like you always do. In Jesus' name, amen. So about 2 weeks ago, I gave a teaching on prayer. And this morning, I want to build on to that. But before we do that, I'd like to encourage you, if you didn't get a chance to watch that one, go back onto our page and watch that recording. But for the benefit of this building that I have said I'm going to do this morning, I just want to go through what we spoke about in prayer. So what we did is we looked at the benefits of prayer. We looked at what prayer does. We said prayer carries us in times of need. We said that prayer is our transportation into our expected outcome. We looked at things like that prayer takes us into the throne room of God and it opens up a line of communication. We also looked at the fact that it activates a relationship with God. And so this morning, I want to build on to that. This morning, I want us to look at, now I've done that. Now I've entered into my closet. Now I've come out of my closet, but nothing. I see no situation changing. I want us to look at the waiting. This morning, I want us to look at the waiting period that happens before manifestation takes place. Now, I want to make an example real quick. The example is quite simple. If you're hungry and you walk into a restaurant and you want something to eat, you are hungry, but you also have an idea of what you want to eat. So you walk into the restaurant and you place an order and you pay for the order, then you wait. In your waiting, it does not take away the hunger. You're still hungry, but you are waiting for your order. You can start throwing your toys out of the cart. You can start pacing up and down. You can start shouting it at the top of your voice. But that is not going to change the process. So that is not going to influence how the chef continues to prepare your meal. He will continue to follow the process. He will continue to get it to be perfected. So he will continue. But you will rant on and on and on. So you are waiting. But there's an expectation that is birthed in your waiting as well. So while you're waiting, you have an expectation. So when we walk out of our prayer closets, there's one thing we are not to leave behind, and that is our expectation. So in waiting, there's a lot of things that happen. However, there's a few things and a few benefits that I want us to look at in waiting, because waiting is not all that bad. Waiting has its own benefits that we, if we were to look into waiting, we would be able to build from that. So the first one that I want us to look at is that waiting makes priorities clearer. So the priorities become clearer. We looked at the fact that prayer keeps us in God's will. That's one of the things that we looked at the previous time. How does that happen in waiting? So in waiting, you then get to establish the importance of that which you are waiting for. It then sets you in place for receiving. So your priority becomes straight. And in some instances, we find that we ask God for wants and we deem them as needs. So in that period of waiting, you then start realizing that that really I can do without. So time beautifies that that aspect of waiting. So it separates the usable from the unusable. And time sobers the mind. So in waiting, you get to learn to sober up. Because when we order, when you are asking for something or you are waiting for something, you tend to be impatient and want to see it happen faster than it should. And time enables you to sober up. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because the adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour." That's quite simple. He could simply throw something that is a lookalike your way when you're in a rush. The second thing that happens in waiting is it develops perseverance. In the book of 2 Kings chapter 5, we find a man called Naaman. And this man had leprosy. And he was one of the king's trusted. And so the word goes around and the king gets to hear that, hey, there's somebody who can actually help Naaman out for you. And there's a man of God in Israel who can actually assist Naaman. And so the king decides, I'm going to make a request to this man of God and I'm going to send it through. So the king writes a letter and we find this request in 2 Kings 5 verse 6 and it reads as follows. The letter that he wrote to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman is now given hope. Naaman, in our instance, has now prayed and is expectant of an answer. Naaman, off he goes. He goes to meet the man of God, and when he gets there, he gets an answer. And the answer says, "Go to the Jordan River and wash 7 times. Wow. I'm sure when he's going there, in his mind he's thinking, I'll get there, man of God will lay hands, amen, hallelujah, and there'll be fireworks, and then off I go. But he gets this instruction that says to him, wash 7 times. He goes to the Jordan River. And the first time he goes in, he washes, and he comes out. I'll make an example with that. So the first time he goes in, it could be you, it could sitting at home, and you're saying, I've been trusting God for marriage, I've been trusting God for a partner. And many a times I've dipped myself into the Jordan River. But I've come out and it hasn't changed. My ring is still, my hand is still blank. Tololo. But I've went in and out. Second time he goes back in, he comes out. Could be you sitting there and you're saying, look, you don't understand. You said prayer will bring me closer to God the last time. You said that if I spend more time, I'll get a revelation of who God is and I'll get a perspective of where I'm going. My perspective will change. But I get that. But I've been praying for my marriage for 4 years. Over and over and over. It's the same battles, Bongi. We are not winning. I'm about to pack up and go. My question to you is, how many times have you dipped? What is your instruction? Naaman goes back in the third time, comes out, looks at his skin, same old, same old. Could be you. You're trusting God for a child and you've been waiting, you've been praying, you've gone to the doctors, you've done everything that you have been instructed to do. But nothing has happened. You could be the woman in that situation, or you could be the man and you're looking at it and you're like, hey, look, I've tried everything. I think maybe a second wife is an option now because I've tried everything that I know. Fourth time, Naaman goes back in, comes back up. Could be you sitting there and you say, you have no idea. I've sent out my CV over and over again. What comes back is, sorry, regrettably, you are an unsuccessful candidate. You don't know what that does to my spirit. I can't wait anymore. I can't take it anymore because my situation is not changing. God knows that when, if I were to get that job, my life could change for the better. Sixth time, he goes into the water, comes back up. Could be you sitting there and you're like, at some point I thought I was called. At some point I believed that this is what God had told me to do. At some point I really, really thought that I heard from God that I should start this business, but every time I send out a proposal, the door gets shut in my face. I could have sworn God told me to start that church, but every time I try and build it, it looks like it goes crumbling down. But Naaman goes back the seventh time. When he comes out, Naaman's skin is restored. Perseverance. In your waiting, you need to carry your expectation with you. Because Naaman, every time he came back up, he looked at his skin because he had an expectation. So what am I saying to you? I'm saying that when you go into your prayer closet over and over again, do not let go of your expectation, because your expectation is what is going to keep you going. Keep your expectation with you in your waiting. Let God be the center of your waiting, because you will then expect to see greater and better things to come. In that perseverance, don't forget to rest. That's the third point. Don't forget to rest. Rest. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1 to 3 reads as follows. God's promise of entering his rest still stands. So we ought to tremble with fear that some of you might fail to experience it. For this good news that God has prepared this rest has been announced to us just as it was to them. But it did them no good because they didn't share the faith of those who listened to God. For only we who believe can rest, can enter his rest. As for others, God said, in my anger, I took an oath, and they will never enter the place of rest. Even though rest is made ready, rest was made ready at creation. However, we need to enter rest. Rest is readily available for take. We need to be ready to receive the rest that God has for us. In waiting, we need to know who we are waiting on. Because when we know who we are waiting on, then we know no matter how long it takes, he is a faithful God. And he will respond. This is the time where we need to go back to the basics, to the place of rest, to the place where we find what we need before we even get to it. Because God is everything that we need. But in that, we also need to learn to be patient. So in the week, I had a chat with my grandmother. And my grandmother knits as a hobby. So she tells me, no, I'm knitting a cap for one of my great-grandchildren. So I said to her, yo, knitting, that is a lot of work. She does a lot of knitting, especially in winter. So she then says to me, no, I'm knitting a cap this time. It's not a winter hat. So I said to her, how long does it take you to knit? And she says to me, no, it takes me about a week and a half. And I said, yo, of doing the same thing. And she said, yes, it takes me a week and a half. And in some instances, it does take me longer. Because if I miss a line, I need to go back and fix it. So it is in the patience. This is what she said. She said, in the patience, that's where perfection happens. She said, patience is perfected in waiting. She said to me, you know, when you are knitting, you have the end picture in mind. You know what you are creating. And so when it doesn't look right, it doesn't fit into the pattern, you have to undo it. But it takes patience. And so I went back into the Word and I found that David had to wait. David was told in advance that, hey, brah, you're gonna rule. You're gonna be king. But David had to wait. David had to wait. But in his waiting, he had to be patient, because he had the understanding and the revelation that what God has promised me, only God can bring to fruition. So what God has promised us, we can do whatever we want to do. We can try and run ahead of God. We can try and be the Sarahs that give our husbands to Haggai so that the promise can come to fruition. We can be the Esau's that take our birthrights and give them to the Jacobs of today so that we could have a quick fix. But David knew that only God had to take Saul off the throne in order for him to take the throne rightfully. So what am I saying to you, to us this morning? My prayer is that you and I will have a new understanding that in our waiting period, it does not mean that nothing is happening, but that it means that even when nothing seems to be happening, God is busy doing something. So when you wait, my brother, my sister, my mother, my father, remember that he who has started a good work will see it to fruition. There's one thing that I want us to remember, and that is when we are waiting, let's not leave behind our expectation. Because expectation is what is going to get us what we need. When you're expecting something, a parent who's expecting a baby, a pregnant woman who is expecting a baby, will wait the 9 months to see the baby. But why is it that when God gives us an instruction, when God gives us a dream, when God gives us a promise, we do not want to wait for it to be completed before we receive it? Let us learn to wait and rest and be patient, because in God, that's where our answers come from. We are made whole by understanding who we are in God. So today I want to say, let us learn to wait, but wait patiently. Rest in God. He loves you. Everything that happens around you, he makes sure that his goodness is revealed. It might take long. That job might not happen right now, but tomorrow that call will come through. That marriage might not turn around as I say amen now, but how many more dips have you done as per your instruction from God? Let us learn to wait and be patient in God. Let us pray. Father, thank you that you'll teach us how to wait on you. That you will teach us, Father, to be open to a new world of prayer and understanding. That everything that we do has an end result, and that end result is always in our favor. Things might not seem like they are working for us now, but Lord, we know that when we hold on to that which you have promised, it shall come to pass, and everything will be perfected in our patience. In the name of Jesus, amen. We thank you for joining us this morning, and I hope that you were blessed by this message, and I hope that prayer will become a lifestyle, that we will carry this into our day-to-day, and feel free to share this message with anyone around you so that the word of God is spread wildly, because that's really what we are here for, to set the captives free, to preach the gospel, and share the love of Christ. Amen.
Now we come before you every single Sunday with a message from the gospel of the good news of Jesus Christ. Every week someone comes to you to inspire you, to remind you of your identity, to remind you of the promises of Jesus Christ. And this morning, I just want to take the opportunity to remind you of why it is that we share that gospel. Words shared by Jesus Christ himself in one of his parables. I'm going to read from the book of Luke chapter 15, verses 3 to 7, and it reads as follows. So Jesus told them this story. If a man has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost, what will he do? Won't he leave the 99 others in the wilderness and go to search for the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he will joyfully carry it home on his shoulders. When he arrives, he will call together his friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, because I have found my lost sheep." In the same way, there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 others who are righteous and haven't strayed away. So the message that we bring every Sunday is not really about us at Connect Christian Church. This message of hope is for you who is not yet a part of God's family. So this morning I'd like to invite you to say a little prayer with me, a repentance prayer. We call it the salvation prayer, inviting Jesus Christ to become Lord and Savior of your life and thereby walking into every promise that Jesus has for you. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you this morning acknowledging that I am a sinner in need of your help. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe in my heart that you died on the cross, that you were buried, and you rose again on the third day. And I receive you this morning into my heart. I invite you, Lord Jesus, to be Lord over my life. I surrender my will to yours, and I say, have your way from this day forward. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. If you've prayed that prayer, I'd like to welcome you to God's family. You are part of a big, big family of joyful people who walk in his promises. Yes, the road will get difficult, but you're surrounded by so many people who will support you. And we would like to send you some resources to get started on this journey. So please send us an email on the details provided on your screen, and we'll get in touch with you. Stay blessed. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 20 says, "This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You are no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here, with as much right to the name Christian as anyone." God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how he got here and what he is building. If you would like to contribute to the work of building God's kingdom at Connect Christian Church, please take note of the banking details displayed on your screen right now. May the Lord bless you as you give.
Just for you, because it was just for me as well. If it hasn't changed your life from today, it has changed mine indifferently. So yes, we're going to see you next week. We can't wait to do so. So please do join us. Do not miss out on another church service. We love you. Goodbye.